My name's Eddie Winters. You're tuned in to the Rock and Roll Coup d'Etat. We have a very special guest on the line all the way from New Jersey. It is my great honor to welcome Mr. Tommy West to the program. Tommy, how are you doing this morning?
I'm fine. How are you? How are you guys?
Oh, we're doing fantastic. It is a great honor to have you on the program. We've got a little applause for you here.
Welcome, Tommy.
Welcome to the program. Tommy, you had a wonderful career as a singer-songwriter, a producer, and you had a team of guys that you were working with, and you had the pleasure of meeting, working with, producing the record Gingerbreadd for Maury Muehleisen, whom we are honoring today. And we wanted to talk to you a little bit about Maury and your relationship with Maury and how you got to know and meet Maury.
Well, Maury was introduced to me by a friend of mine from college named Joe Salviolo. He was Maury's English teacher. And he heard Maury sing and play and brought him up to my office. And I listened to about 10 seconds. Cashman listened to about 10 seconds. He said, this guy is unique. And we signed him and later produced an album for Capitol Records, which didn't do well sales-wise. Got a lot of critical review and paved the way for him to play with Jim Croce.
Right. And the when you first met him, he was brought in. Your friend Joe had brought him up to New York to meet you. What was your first impression of Maury when you met him? His personality as a youngster with a guitar. What was your first impression of Maury?
He was a genius. It didn't take me long to figure it out. Some people, there are a lot of good players and singers, as you well know. But he played the song called The Song I Heard.
Right.
And I looked at Cashman. Cashman looked at me and he said, we got to get this guy in the studio.
Yeah.
Wow. And immediately. There's a record now of Maury's demos called Before the Ever Since. And these were recordings. At what point did he make these demos? Did he do these demos prior to your meeting? Or was this after you'd heard him? You were like, you should make some demo recordings.
I think these were songs he'd already recorded in his house.
That's right. Wow. And you just... So you, how long before meeting him, hearing him, did you arrange to get a recording underway?
We tried right away.
And you recorded up in the record plant in New York.
Oh, wow.
It's actually the Hit Factory.
I'm sorry, the Hit Factory up in New York.
Another legendary joint.
And I know. the thing that I really noticed about the Gingerbreadd album is the arrangements on these records. Did you have anything to do with writing these arrangements for these beautiful songs?
They weren't written. They were just played. Maury would play and sing at the same time.
Wow.
Which is unusual.
And as the songwriter, he'd kind of have the whole arrangement in his head.
That's right.
Wow. You're not far off with genius. I mean, that's pretty much the definition of it. When they can see the whole big picture like that, and it's just in them.
Absolutely. The tracks, they really, some of them in comparison to the demos just seem so fleshed out. There's double tracked harmonies on some of the parts, of course. Love Is Just a Passing Thing is a great example of just these melodies intertwining, the kind of harpsichord sound as it trails out. How long did this Gingerbreadd record take to get recorded?
A few months.
Is that right?
Which I guess then was shorter than average time.
Right.
To record an album.
And so the record wraps up and was released. Now it didn't commercially sell very well, but it did reach a very critical acclaim. What was your reaction when the album was released?
My reaction?
As far as when as it didn't move as you were pleased.
I didn't like it.
Right.
Yeah.
But what started to happen was this groundswell within the business and within the musicians. He started to get calls to play on other people's records. Because as far as the guitar player, there was never a better guitar player than Maury.
Right. And then how far off now? Your friend Joe introduced Maury to your friend Jim Croce.
Right.
And as the story goes, Jim actually was helping promote Gingerbreadd with Maury, backing him up on certain shows here or there.
Yeah.
At what point, I guess the sound of Maury's music and his songwriting had a somewhat of an influence on Jim's work. Can you tell me a little bit about what that impact was like?
Well, they started to work together. They got along very well. And as Jim would write the songs, Maury would participate. He tried to make it more unique.
Right.
Well, it would seem to me, and I come here as a musician myself, but basically a novice. I don't really know what Jim Croce's influences were, but he would seem to be a more traditional Greenwich Village style folk
right.
singer. And Maury, when I listen to his solo tracks, I hear this beautiful, English or almost like a Baroque influence
right.
to his style of folk, and it's got some more ornamentation.
Very classical.
Yeah, man.
Right, and he had a classical piano training that probably kind of gave him a wider perspective, I guess, when approaching the thing that also shocks me about Maury is that he'd only been playing guitar for a very short period of time by the time you met him.
I mentioned before you came on, Tommy, I started playing guitar when I was 14. Mm-hmm. I'm 46 now. I'm still okay.
still no.
So to hit the ground running like that.
But Maury, of course, was 3 years of playing guitar. By the time, I guess, he'd done the Gingerbreadd record.
And he was super hip. It was all together, man.
Yeah, absolutely incredible. Moving forward with the Jim Croce. Now, you produced the three original Jim Croce records. Can you tell us a little bit about those sessions when you were doing these records? Jim had these songs. Did they record most of these tracks live? Was there a lot of overdubbing when they were doing these tracks?
Totally live.
All live.
Son of a gun.
Jim on guitar, Maury on guitar. I played piano.
Wow.
Gary Chester on drums and Joe Mack on bass.
And these records were recorded pretty quickly, if I'm not mistaken.
The whole album took about 3 weeks.
Wow. Wow. And the rate, too, which is incredible. I mean, that's record business back in those days. I mean, Jim's three records came out in a span of time of 2 years.
Yeah.
Right.
That was the cycle back then. They'd want you to have, a couple albums out every year.
Yeah, it's absolutely incredible. And so, and I know that you'd played, obviously, on the record. But you would also, there's a couple of live appearances, maybe for television, where they got you back up on the piano to play. What were those experiences, I guess, hopping on stage with Maury and Jim?
It was a very unique experience because of the live part of it. And we had played together a long time.
Right.
Jim and I started playing together in 1961, actually, when we were in college.
Wow.
Wow.
So we had this symbiotic relationship, and add Maury to that. For three people, we made a lot of noise.
Right.
Yeah. Now, the rest of the guys playing on that first album, you mentioned that it took 2 weeks to record. So, like, a lot of the recorded performances, they've maybe heard, like, the demo or gotten a quick run-through. like, you know, the session musicians, the drummer and the bassist that you just mentioned, yeah. You know, they were kind of like, you know, ready to roll with that stuff.
Well, I would write out some chord sheets, and we'd go in the studio, and Jim and Maury would start to play, and I'd join in. And it took about a half hour to get a format down.
Man, this is the stuff.
And then we press the button, and the rest is history.
Wow, right. Yeah.
Wow. And I, you know, and as you were watching Jim's career skyrocket with Maury and Jim on television shows, I mean, you must have been sitting back. I mean, as a record producer, as somebody who had known Jim, had worked with Jim and Maury and recorded this record, and then you have Bad, Bad Leroy Brown, You Don't Mess Around With Jim. You have these tracks skyrocketing, you know, on the charts. That this must have been an incredible time for you personally as an artist and as a producer.
I knew my life would never be the same.
Yeah, because a record kept coming out and it kept being a hit.
I mean, it's and it must be. I can only imagine, because it was just this the nonstop. I mean, the strength of those records right off the bat. I don't think the industry was really ready for a Jim Croce, because these songs, you know, Operator, these huge songs, and of course you've got Maury's guitar lines that you know make this harmony, it makes it timeless. I mean, it really must have been a sensational period of time.
Maury was the cherry on the top of the sundae.
Yeah.
And once we got that worked out, he would go and play someplace, and he would be surrounded after the show by young folk singers wanting to know how he did this and how he did that, and what kind of strings did he use. And
right.
He was a unique artist.
I'd have been one of those guys.
Yes. And it seems, you know, that's another thing that people like to talk about is the intricacy, the style, the finger-picking style that Maury, I guess, had, and especially with his work with Jim. A lot of guitar players, you know, I mean, want to know how does that sound achieved. It's one of those things that people must come up to you all the time and ask you, what's the secret to Maury's sound?
It's 40 years later, and I'm still getting the same questions.
Is that right? Absolutely incredible. And really quickly wrapping up the we're talking about the third Jim Croce record that came out, the I've Got a Name. Now this record, as we know, was recorded I guess a little over a week prior to both Jim and Maury dying in that plane crash. Mm-hmm. This record came out and they'd finished it. You had to do a lot of, like, I guess, putting the final touches on this record. That must have been probably one of the hardest things I could ever imagine a producer and a friend to have to do after two really great friends and have gone and left us. What was that experience like, putting that record together?
I didn't want to finish it. I wanted to keep going.
Yeah,
they kept remixing things and making excuses to keep the studio going.
I know what that's like when you only have the one thing left. You want to savor every moment of it.
Exactly.
Right.
And in your case, you know, you might have known this is the last time that Tommy West is going to work with Jim Croce and Maury Muehleisen. So I want this,
Muehleisen. Yes.
Muehleisen. Sorry, I want this to stand.
That's right.
And it keeps me on my toes.
I was going to ask the song, and a brilliant song, Maury's song, "Salon and Saloon." We played the demo earlier on the program this morning, and this happened to be one of Jim's, I guess, the final song he recorded in the studio.
That's right.
Well, tell us a little bit about this particular track, because it was a gift. Or a surprise to Maury?
Maury came in, he said, I have this song I want you to hear. And Jim liked it. And so he decided to record it with me on piano instead of guitar.
Wow.
And it gives it almost a Gershwin, Jerome Kern feel.
Right. And the way that the melody moves around, and just on the piano, by the way, played by yourself, is just such a, I don't know what the word is. I have a lack of words to describe what it, the feeling and the sensation.
I believe I was Randy Newman.
There's a guy to aim for.
Exactly. it leaves this mark, and it just says that the work is, I don't know, that there's more to come, and it's just such an unexpected bookend to that career and that recording.
Bittersweet coda.
Yes, if you will. Mm. Tommy, I know we're pressed for time, and I want to thank you so much for being on the program. I do want to ask, in the 40 years since Maury has passed, your thoughts on Maury, have they, over time, have they, what do you think about when Maury runs through your head now 40 years later after all of, these Gingerbreadd records and the Jim Croce records? Is there something that comes to your mind when you think about Maury? Is there something that reminds you of Maury?
Well, first of all, I miss him as a friend.
Right.
Like you do.
Secondly, I'm thrilled that I got a chance to work with somebody as good as he is. And if you told me 40 years ago the music was going to last this long, I would have said you're nuts.
Wow.
But it did.
I wouldn't have.
It really did, and hopefully with the, you coming on the program, and later on when we speak to Mary, Maury's sister, we will bring a new audience to this music. It's absolutely,
Mary has single-handedly brought Maury to the fore.
Exactly. Without her, I to be honest with you, I wouldn't have had this information, and to be able to get all this music together, and it's. I really appreciate your work, and you obviously your production, your friendship with both Jim and Maury, and of course I very much appreciate you taking the time out today to speak with us.
My pleasure.
Thank you so much, Tommy, for being on the program.
Thank you, Tommy.
Have a good one, guys.
You got it. Take care, Tommy.
Bye. That's
Tommy West, all the way from New Jersey.
What a cool guy.
Very, very cool. Eddie Winters, you're tuned in to the Rock and Roll Coup d'Etat. We've got one very special guest on the line, all the way from New Jersey, Miss Mary Muehleisen. Mary, how are you doing this morning?
Hi, Eddie. How are you?
I'm doing
fine.
I'm doing fantastic. We've got some applause for you.
It is an honor.
It is an honor to speak with you and have you on the program this morning.
Thank you. I'm personally.
Thank you. So we've been talking about your brother Maury all morning long, and his work, his life, his contribution to popular music, as well as the career of Jim Croce, and it is we're so excited to have you on to let us in and share some insights into Maury's life. You guys are from a huge family, and how many kids are in the family?
There were eight of us.
Eight of guys.
Mm-hmm. Eight children.
And Maury was the second of eight?
Yes.
Second of eight. And you are Maury's younger sister, is that correct?
I am 1 year younger than Maury. We have a sister a few years older, 4 or 5 years older than Maury. And then a sister younger than me by 3 years, and then 4 boys after that.
Wow. That's a big family. Let's talk about the family growing up. Was it a musical family? Was it a very...
My question exactly. I want to know this.
Yeah.
Hi, Jeremy.
Hi, Mary. It's so wonderful to have you on the show.
Thank you. We always had a piano in the house, and Mom and Dad were in the church choir, and they always got together with their friends, and when family came over, there was always singing around the piano.
There you go.
Wow. And as story goes, Maury he started playing piano at an early age.
Yes, he was only about 9 years old when he started piano lessons. We would walk to Charlie Kreiser's house, who was the organist for the cathedral choir that my parents were in, and I'd sit on the front porch or in the hallway and wait for him while he took his lesson.
Oh, wow.
Man.
So he was...
This is like a Rockwell painting that you're filling in for us, Mary.
It's a happy memory.
Oh, boy.
At nine, how would you describe, I guess, how he took to the music lessons?
He, like Tommy West says, was a genius, and
right.
it just seemed to come naturally to him. He actually wanted, at a younger age than that, to play guitar, but we didn't have a guitar, and that was all because of Elvis Presley.
Oh, wow.
But... So my dad said, well, we've got a piano, and Maury said, no, thanks. And then he one day sat down and started playing the song Tammy.
Tammy, Tammy, Tammy's
Tammy,
in
Tammy.
Love.
Right. Yep.
So
I got the gig.
My dad said, you know what, you need to let us give you piano lessons, because if you can do that without a piano lesson, you have ability.
Wow.
So
that is lovely to hear.
So they started him at nine.
So,
he played classical music so beautifully. If you thought he sounded good on the guitar, you should have heard him on the piano.
Wow. And he showed signs of just the genius that, you know, very quickly adapting to the piano. Was it Elvis that brought the influence of rock and roll to the household?
Definitely Elvis was, you know, Maury's first indication that he wanted to do something like that. He just had such an ear for music, but we listened as young children to records and the radio.
Right.
As teenagers, we couldn't get enough. The first thing we would do was turn on the radio and listen to all the Hot 100s, and Maury was very meticulous about, you know, checking off what songs he was interested in, and you know, almost everything got checked off, needless to say.
It sounds like the Beatles and the Beach Boys were definitely going through his filter.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
That's
everybody.
Right.
So he,
well,
you know, Bobby V.
Ooh.
That was Bobby Villeen.
Bobby V was his stage name.
Mm-hmm.
So he basically was turned on to that whole, the explosion of rock and roll in that early part of the 60s, coming out of the 50s with the Elvis. What was Maury like as far as a student in school, while he was doing the, studying the piano and going to school, he seemed like a pretty smart kid. Did he do well in school and excelled in that region?
Yes, he was a great student. The teachers all loved him. It was kind of hard to follow him up the next year because they expected something of me. and they weren't going to find it. I was kind of a, you know.
Yeah, you had some shoes to fill.
Big shoes to fill when you're following somebody like Maury. The teachers all loved him. Of course, we had mostly nuns, all in grammar school and high school. And, you know, some of them just, set their eyes on this kid who they even recognized as a talent
Wow.
at a young age.
And so Maury didn't, this is what I find really fascinating about Maury is he picked up a guitar at 17.
Yes.
And that, which is fascinating because, I mean, you know, only a few years later there he is signed to Capitol Records. What, how did he come into the guitar as far as, you know, when did he finally get his hands on one?
Well, we all had to, you know, help living in a big family. To make our way, and I babysat, and he delivered newspapers. So when he had enough money, he was a junior in high school at 17, and he ran downtown when he had $50 in his hot little hands to Sears and bought a Silvertone.
That was the Sears brand.
Yeah.
Yep.
So did he get an electric or an acoustic guitar?
No, an acoustic.
Okay.
And came home, he bought a $3 songbook and ran up to his room and,
probably,
you know,
exhausted that in a day or two. Sounds like it.
Well, you know, I think having the classical piano background helped him tremendously. But
His ear was probably sharp as a tack.
Right.
Already.
Oh, yeah.
Eddie and I have been talking about Maury for weeks, but we were just outside, you know, talking about those tracks and those seminal artists that make people go, this is what I want to do. Following Elvis, do you recall something that sort of excited Maury's latent interest, like around the time that he got that Silvertone guitar? What was it that really galvanized him to run downtown to Sears? Like after Elvis, because Elvis and I mentioned the Beach Boys and the Beatles, in a sense, they're all our influences, you know. Everybody's
sure.
got that in common.
Sure.
But was there anybody that, like, Maury saw on TV or a record that he could not keep off the turntable, that
well,
sort of
Beatles?
Okay.
The very first Beatles album.
Oh man.
We had one of those record players that looked like a suitcase.
Oh, right. Yeah.
And you lifted the lid, and then you could unhinge the back, and the two speakers would go off to the left and right.
Right.
And we would put the Beatles album on, Meet the Beatles, and just play that over and over and over again. And he wouldn't want to play the whole thing all the way through all the time. The first time maybe we did, but then he was constantly standing there picking the needle up, moving it back just a tiny bit, just so that he could hear exactly what they did there.
Oh, hear the
yeah.
parts and
yeah.
figure them out.
He
picks up the guitar at 17 and he starts working on it. At what point was he, did he start composing his own music right away? Did that take a little while for him to get into?
Almost immediately. When I remember the first couple songs that he did were covers of Killing Me Softly.
Wow.
Holy.
And of course, things like, oh gosh, the new Christy Minstrels and, you know, songs that, the folky kind of songs.
Right.
And so he would do a couple of those. Oh, Mr. Tambourine Man.
Oh, right.
Mr. Tambourine Man and Killing Me Softly. And then after that, I don't really recall him doing a lot of covers. He just got right to writing his own songs.
It's so amazing. I mean, it's his college career, I guess, is pretty notable because he meets Joe Salviolo in the college era. And what year did Maury leave high school to go to college?
He graduated in June of 1967.
In 67.
And went down to Glassboro.
And that's where he meets Joe, who, correct me if I'm wrong, Joe was a teacher of Maury's, is that correct?
I noticed that Tommy said that he was Maury's English teacher. I don't recall that he actually taught Maury. He was a communications professor, but I believe Tommy.
Yeah.
So if Maury took an English class with him, then that's probably so.
I correct Eddie's English frequently on the show, so
right.
in a sense you could say that I'm his teacher.
Yeah, exactly.
You're funny.
But
Maury didn't meet him that year because Maury didn't last too long in his freshman year because it was the '60s.
Right.
So he had to come home for a little bit. And he went back again the next year and met Joe Salviolo. It was either very late 68 or early 69. And they, they were two guys with guitars, and they decided to do a folk show on campus that they did, I think it was February of 69. And everybody just loved them, and Joe said, "My God, I can't believe, you know, all these songs that you've written." And I went to Villanova with a guy who is, you know, just working on a production company in New York. And I have another friend who was working with him, but kind of walked away from his contract. And I was wondering if you could make a cassette of your music. A reel-to-reel, actually, is what he wanted.
Right.
So, Maury made a reel-to-reel that summer of, let's see, so if he met him in 69, he made that in the summer of 70, and Joe took it up, and like Tommy said, they wanted to see him right away, and they signed him to a contract, songwriting contract, in September of, now I'm getting confused.
Is that 1970, is that right?
1970. And they, that was actually 69.
Oh, yeah. Wow.
In 69, they signed him, and then they made an album. They recorded the album, the Gingerbreadd Songs, in the summer of 1970.
And it's I read this online that Joe actually, he quit his job to become Maury's manager to shop these recordings around. I mean, that must have been, I guess, for Maury to be, a young songwriter, a young musician, to have somebody just to be so impressed with his talent to walk away from the career to put the trust into Maury's talent. Do you remember at the time Maury's enthusiasm, I guess, about that specific period?
Oh my gosh! Yes, he had a little habit of hopping on the, you know, he would stand up on the front of his feet and his heels would leave the ground.
Right.
Yeah. He'd kind of bounce around. He was, very, you know, excited all the time about everything, and so when Joe did that, it showed Joe's belief in him. Joe did have some contacts with, you know, some people in Philadelphia and New York and some friends. Quitting the job, you know, that's debatable, whether or not it was the right thing to do.
Right.
But he tried his best to get Maury gigs. And Maury did open for Jimmy Webb at the main point in Philadelphia.
Right.
He opened for Janis Ian at the Bitter End in New York. So he was getting him some recognition here and there, but we can't tell what would have happened if Maury had been able to get a management team that Cashman and West would have liked to have gotten for him.
Right. And so he goes up to New York, and as we were speaking with Tommy earlier in the program, Tommy right away, both him and Cashman, they listened to his music and were knocked out right away. And it seemed like they just agreed to get him a deal, get him starting working on this album. When Maury shows back up from New York, he must have come back into the house. And I can't imagine what was a little bit of that. I mean, was the family in full support of the son going off to New York to pursue this career?
Yes. I mean, you know, we had parents who, of course, would have liked for him to be the first one of us to go and get a college education, but they recognized his talent, and they were thrilled with the fact that the these record producers in New York were so interested in him, and they said, "Well, we were going to support you through a college education, and you really do have talent, and we can see that this is what you're really more interested in, so we will be here and support you in any way we can." And it was really more moral and emotional support than financial, because, you know, we really weren't a well-off family.
Right.
And there were still so many of us that were going through school at the time.
Seems like that was a recurring theme with Maury. People, when faced with his gifts, it would just stop them, and they go, "We got a live one."
Yeah.
You know, here's a guy. So his talent was easily recognized.
Definitely, and his sweet personality. I mean,
it goes a long way.
Anybody who met him, I've honestly never heard anybody say anything bad about Maury. He just he was happy. He loved to smile at people and open his guitar case and play a song for anybody, whether it was one person or 20 or 50 or, you know, the large crowds that eventually got to hear him play. But and all he wanted to do was make people smile.
And so the Gingerbreadd record comes out. He went up to New York. He recorded that at the Hit Factory, and which is a legendary studio, and records this record. It didn't take very long to record the album. And do you have a memory of hearing the Gingerbreadd record for the very first time?
Oh, I definitely do. Maury and Joe Salviolo brought the first copy of the completed album home to our home on South Hermitage Avenue in Trenton, to our little house, and my parents were out at a meeting in Princeton for a political person at the governor's home, and Maury was disappointed, so we called them, and they said, "Well, bring it up to, you know, Governor Hughes's house." And he said, "Oh, no, I want you to come home. I want you and, you know, all the kids to hear it all at the same time."
Beautiful.
Wow.
Beautiful.
And so so they said, okay. So we waited for them, and Maury set the living room up with that record player, and he actually removed the two speakers and put them on little TV trays on different sides of the room.
Oh, for the separation.
So we would have surround sound.
Right.
Fancy.
And he darkened the room and told each of us where he wanted us to sit. And then he put a little candle on and set the mood. And we listened. And, you know, I can speak for myself, but I'm sure it was an emotional time for all of my brothers and sisters and my parents. And to listen to those songs.
Because you were in the dark.
So, we were in the dark.
So you could only imagine everyone's having the same gamut of emotions.
Exactly.
You are.
And so proud.
And I got to know, was this an acetate? So before they actually press an album to go out to stores, they'd have a stamper, and they'd press like a couple of copies for the artist, the producer, and so on to take. So you'd have it in a blank cover. Was this one of those, do you recall?
No, it wasn't. It was the actual first album.
I
remember him, you know, slitting it open, and we saw this fantastic,
the beautiful cover.
Artwork.
Yeah. Right.
I mean, I didn't know what to do, you know, first, and he kind of just set the album up there where we could all just look at the cover.
Right.
We weren't passing it around the room or anything. And the thing that was so amazing was that we had all been privy to hearing these songs floating through our home during the time that he made it. You know, if we were home doing homework or getting ready for bed or doing dishes, we would hear him not only upstairs in his bedroom working out these songs during the time before they were recorded, but, you know, he would come down, he would bound down the stairs to the living room, where half of the living room was taken up by a baby grand piano.
Wow.
Holy.
And he worked all his songs out on the piano as well as the guitar. So these songs were kind of ingrained in all of us in their original versions. And then to hear that our brother had an album.
Right.
That people were going to be able to buy in stores. And so that was the only copy that there was. And then soon enough, we heard that, you know, that we'd all be getting them. But I remember when I heard that the stores had them, I ran up the street on Hermitage Avenue to a bookstore that said they were going to order them, and they said they haven't come in yet. So I came back down to State Street and ran downtown to a record store And they said, they just came. And so I wanted to pay for one because I wanted to be part of Maury and
sure,
make some money.
Right.
It was so exciting, and I ran home and put it on the record player, and Maury wasn't even home that day, but I remembered, like, oh, my gosh, you know, my brother has a record.
Yeah.
I can't imagine, because, I mean, in those days, you know, making a record, bringing a record home to your own household, it's so far off in your mind. I mean, now we have CDs, CDRs, and it's a lot easier
to... It's not even as romantic as making one in your garage. You can just make one in your bedroom or
right.
your bathroom.
Exactly.
But back then, to have made a record and for it to have been in a store was a pretty big deal.
A huge deal. And, of course, with the artwork that went involved and the whole layout of the record, I can imagine physically feeling this record in your hands has to have been, especially at that time, just such a mind-blowing experience, probably for you and your family, and obviously for Maury as well.
Oh, definitely. I mean, I still get my copy out all the time, and pull out the sheet that was inside the insert had all Maury's own hand-printed.
Ooh.
Lyrics to all of his songs,
right?
And it was a beautiful album, a beautiful package, and Capitol Records and Tommy West and Terry Cashman and their partner, their legal partner Phil Kernett, they were the ones who signed him, and they just did a fantastic job, and we've been eternally grateful to them for everything they did, not only for Maury but also for Jim,
right?
And of course, Maury's album, as you were saying earlier, is what led Maury and Jim to become friends, because Tommy West, who had been friends with Jim in college, they kind of had a little bit of a falling out when Jim and Ingrid became disillusioned by the music business. So Maury came along just in time for them to have another artist to promote. But they said to Maury, you know, we've got this friend, and we know music is in his soul too, and if you could meet him and if you get along, maybe he could play some rhythm when you go around to promote the Gingerbreadd album. So Maury said sure, and you know, Jim had introduced them already once, but they met up in the studios in New York, and they hit it off immediately. They became great friends very easily, and
right.
So Jim started trying to learn rhythm parts to Maury's things and went on some gigs. Maury did the opening of a local TV show in Trenton, a TV station, Channel 52, I think it was. And Jim
went
to that with him. And whatever little things Joe could get for Maury, Jim came along to whatever. But he was at our house all the time, because when they would be going up to New York to record Jim's songs, he would take a train from Philadelphia to Trenton, and then he would come to our house, which was maybe a mile and a half or so from the train station to our home, and we'll be like, well, Jim's here, you know, and we're going to go up to New York, and so they did, and then they'd come back, and Jim would never just get back on a train from Trenton to Philadelphia. He'd come home with Maury, and they'd sit and talk to us and play. And it wasn't, the funny thing is, it wasn't like it was Jim Croce coming into our living room.
Right.
It was Maury's friend, Jim, who backed him on his album. You know, not on his album, but on his promo of the album.
Right, right.
And so then next thing you know, Maury was saying to Jim, well, you know, what have you done besides covers? And Jim says, well, I'm working on a song about a guy named Jim. I'm working on a song about saving time in a bottle. And Maury would say, well, let me hear it. And then Maury would go, do-do-do-do, you know, and
right.
say, how's this sound? And they recorded it, like five songs, and sent a cassette tape to Tommy West. And Jim sort of with his tail, you know, between his legs, saying, is there something you can do for me? I know we kind of fell away from each other. And Tommy said, yeah, you know, this is a whole different sound. That's you and Maury.
Right.
And he's our guy. You know, both of you get up here, and we need to record this and find find a way to get it out, to have people hear this.
It's a great perspective to talk about Jim Croce, because everybody knows Jim Croce from the success that he'd had a couple years following this time period. But you being introduced to Jim as Maury's friend, what was your immediate impression of Jim Croce, hanging out, being Maury's friend, and what was their dynamic like as friends?
They seem to suit each other so well. And I remember the first time Maury said, I'm going to bring this new friend over. It was, 1971, I said, let me think. I don't remember. But anyway, it was right after Maury met him. Maury met him in the summer of 70, and by October, he wanted all of us to meet this new friend. So he brought him to our home, and we were sitting in Mom and Dad's living room, and Ingrid came with him, and they were all just excited to play songs for us. Jim was very quiet. I saw him kind of studying all of us, and maybe he was a very famous for studying people anywhere he went, whether
right.
they were walking down the street or in a train station. But I could see him looking at each of us, and you know, you get 8 little Irish Catholic kids, you know, ranging from, I think my brothers were maybe 10 at that time, up to my sister who was in her 20s. And we, we probably were quite a brood for him to study.
Right.
But he was looking at us like, okay, well, you know, that's probably Peggy Ann. And I remember him telling me this about her, and that's got to be Mary, and that's got to be Ann, and oh gosh, Joe, Tom, Michael, Robert, how am I going to tell what he told me about them? So, you know, he was studying all of us. I could see him looking and trying to figure out, you know, what did Maury say about them? But it was kind of fun to watch him. And then once they opened their guitar cases and played for us, they became all, you know, very, very comfortable with one another, and it was fun to have that little private thing. Again, not thinking that it was Jim Croce. This
right.
was, you know, this was more about Maury and this guy who was going to play guitar with him.
Sure.
It was so funny. But then it grew, and, you know, we were excited for Jim when Cashman and West liked hearing Jim's songs with Maury playing lead. But then there was sort of a little tinge of like, oh, but what about Maury?
Right.
You know, so, but, you know, Maury was happy to help Jim. He could also see that these songs were going to be very commercial. When Maury's album was first brought out with Capitol, they kind of had a changeover in personnel and their offices. A lot of the people were going from New York to California. So distance and personnel, it kind of put a crimp in any promotion of Maury's. And then the timing went so well for Jim's music. And Maury still got to shine his star because of people, you know, seeing him out on the road.
Right.
But at that time, they were only seeing him out on the road. And we weren't all getting that feedback mm-hmm. of, how interested people were in Maury.
Right.
Until many years later when we saw videos on YouTube and stuff like
sure.
that. We were seeing them at the same time as everybody else.
So let's go back to when these recordings that Maury plays on of Jim's, Tommy West, he gets those, and they're like, we've got to record these. And they set up the recording of Jim's record right after, I guess, you know, a little time has passed after the Gingerbreadd record. At this point, they're going back up to New York. They're doing the recording. Was Maury's take on this like, this is another gig that I'm doing? And did he kind of? It takes a humble person to kind of put your own career on pause for a second or that facet of your career on pause to go ahead and help out a friend of yours, basically. Mm-hmm. Did he talk about his excitement or, I guess, with working on Jim's music and
yeah.
and what that sound was turning out to be?
Yeah, he was very excited for Jim and excited to be a part of it, and willing to, you know, put his own career on the hold. If he was anything, he was humble, and you can see that. You can see that even in the videos if you watch the YouTube, you know,
right,
renditions of their songs. They just got along so well, and Maury was happy for him, and it really was supposed to be a temporary thing. Cashman and Wes knew that with the record deal that they had gotten Jim, that they were going to try and get, you know, the three record deal records out very quickly. And as soon as those were done, they were going to work with Maury again. So
right.
he had that, you know, in his mind and his heart that as soon as that last record was done, and things happened so fast.
Of course.
That he knew the time was coming that he would be able to share some more of what he had written. But, it did take quite some time, actually. From the time Jim sent the tapes to Tommy, the cassette tape of five songs, that was in February of 71. And it was actually a few months later that Phil Kernet, the lawyer of Blending Well, went to Europe and was able to secure a record deal in Europe and the money that would help them to record the songs. So it wasn't till October of 71 that they recorded at the Hit Factory the songs, 11 songs for Jim's first album, because they were very nice to wait for Ingrid to have her baby.
Right.
AJ?
Right.
AJ. Now, we always called him Adrian.
Sure.
Right.
That's what everybody called him back then.
Now, Mary, it seems to me that the first time that Maury heard Time in a Bottle, he'd have had to have gone, as a very intelligent man, a sensitive musician, like, I think you got something here. Do you remember the first time you heard that song and had your brother played on it? Were you hearing that song for the first time just played by Jim, or did you hear it when they had finally recorded the version that everyone is familiar with now?
I think there was a little bit of time. I got married in October of 71, so I moved across town with my husband. And so I wasn't home all the time. But if I was in the house in those early stages, it was right around the time that they recorded the album in October of 71, and I married in October of 71.
Oh, wow. Wow.
But in those months leading up to that, Maury was home a lot, again, working those songs out on our piano and on his guitar upstairs. When he wasn't at Jim's, he was home. The piano was a great help to him. I can't tell you how exactly he did it, but he would write out, or not write out, but work all his songs out on both of those instruments. And so I did hear a lot of Jim's songs first at home, just Maury's parts. And
right.
Then when the album came out, that was the first time I really heard everything put together.
And you just hear your brother all over that, all of the counterpoint that he adds in that, all of those little sort of like passing chords that he plays, you know, it pretty much makes the song. And we imagine, you know, we're starting from a very good place because Jim Croce, an inestimable songwriter, but all of the, I call it fairy dust, all of the joints and hinges of Maury's arrangement in it, you can't hear the song without that stuff.
Right.
No, you can't.
As Tommy West says, it's the cherry on top, really, to this great songwriting. And so, the Jim's first record is a huge success. It has, you know, obviously Operator being a really giant song. A lot of songs on that record. Do you recall the first time hearing Jim Croce and your brother on the radio for the first time? And what that kind of sensation must have been like for you?
Well, I heard them probably a couple times locally, but I really remember being struck with the fact that they were going to be famous when Ray and I were on a vacation camping in a campground down in Sarasota, Florida, and we were sitting by a pool, and it was 1972, believe it or not. I think it was May of 72. The album came out in April of 72. So I had only really been listening to that album for about a month at home. And I mean, just the first couple notes I heard in the air around the pool, and I'm like, oh my God, Ray, Maury and Jim are on the radio in Florida. You know, it was so exciting. I was like, people in Florida are hearing him. And I ran to a phone booth, and I called home and told my mom. I said, Maury and Jim are on the radio in Florida. And she said, oh my gosh, and I think they're down in Louisiana right now. She said, I can't call them. I don't know how to get in touch with them. And so she was excited, too, because we were only hearing maybe our local little radio station was, you know, kind enough to play it at home. But it was
being states away, I mean, in another part of the country and hearing it. It must have, I mean, talk about shivers. I mean, and especially in those days where it was just different markets. I mean, that's like a world away hearing it in Florida as opposed to being up in New Jersey. You know, that's
right. And to think that this was already now May of 1972, and they perished in September of 73.
Right. Mm.
So I'm just realizing, you know, less, you know, just about a little over a year before, how that they were making an impact in the country.
Right.
Yeah.
And little did I know that they were also making an impact in Europe, because only a few months later, in September, they were on a European tour.
Right.
I mean, that was so far-fetched, you know, for us to think, you know, people across the ocean also wanted to hear this. But, of course, they had their European deal.
Right. I mean, the amount of touring that Maury and Jim had done for the, in support of these records is pretty staggering. I mean, the amount of television appearances, live recordings that have just in that short period of time. Do you remember sitting down and seeing your brother on television on one of these occasions, seeing him and being like, wow, my brother's famous.
Yeah. Oh yeah, definitely. I mean, he actually called home from backstage at the Johnny Carson show.
Is that right?
And said, make sure everybody's up and watching. And it was so exciting. Actually, I think I took a picture of the TV screen.
Sure, sure. So
I only had a little Instamatic with the little square cube on the top.
Right.
And, you know, but I remember being, like, how do you capture your brother on the Johnny Carson show? You know, there were no VCRs. There was nothing. I was like, oh, my God, Maury's on TV.
And that was kind of like the peak of the mountain, too, to be on Tonight Show when Johnny Carson.
Right. I mean, it's like the you know, the it's like an Ed Sullivan. It's one of those kinds of
with the Beatles.
Right.
No VCRs either. You had to stay up and watch it.
I mean,
and Johnny Carson was so nice to. I mean, Maury was not the main. You know, he was Jim's lead guitarist. He was his, for lack of a better term, sideman, even though he really was more of a duo.
Right.
But when Jim sang one song, and Johnny Carson called him over to the sofa. Maury was, you know, sitting on the stage, and Johnny Carson was very nice to Jim, and then he said, you know, something like, who's that fella over there? I mean, he's great on the guitar.
Wow.
So, and Jim said, you know, Maury's name, and it was really nice, because not everybody gets mentioned like that. So
right.
It was a big thrill.
And, you know, one of the things that I noticed about virtually every concert that Jim Croce played is the introduction. And I and the careful love that he displays just by introducing Maury, calling him his one man band, or mm-hmm. you know, various things, you can hear it and see it when he says that he's got obviously a large admiration for him, and it's really nice to see. And I mean, countless recordings I've listened to, every time he takes that moment. Mm-hmm. And acknowledges mm-hmm. Maury as he's on stage with him.
I mean, they were just great friends. You know, early on, they stayed in hotel rooms together.
Right.
It wasn't until a little bit later, when more money was coming in, that the record company could, you know, say, you know, you can each have your own hotel room.
Wow.
But they were great friends. I mean, I remember going up to see them at the bitter end, and we got there early enough that, you know, we weren't really over at the bitter end. They said, come over to our hotel room. And we went up to the hotel room and sat on the bed, the two single beds. You know, back then there
right.
were single beds in hotel rooms, not always double beds like they do now. And we would just sit there and talk. I mean, Maury was always so excited, and any time he was within driving distance of home, he would always say, you know, Jim and I are going to be here, Jim and I are going to be there, who can come, you know, make sure you come. You know, we'll leave tickets, or just, you know, tell somebody you're my sister or my brother, and, you know, I'll get you in, you know, come to the stage door. He always told us exactly where or how to get in.
Wow.
Man, oh man.
You know?
And so it's, you must have seen Maury and Jim perform, probably, I guess, while this huge rise was happening, how many times do you think you were able to come and see them perform on these larger stages?
I would say, you know, maybe 10 or 12.
Wow.
Because, you know, you had to drive into New York. Now, of course, I was in my early 20s. Our sister was in her older, higher 20s.
Right.
And so, you know, we could drive in, but then if we could, we would take the boys in, the younger boys.
Okay.
And so we would go to the bitter end, but only to one show. If they were there for a week, we would just go up for one show,
right.
either all together, or somebody would go one night and somebody would go another night. Main Point, same thing. You know, one night out of a gig that would last a couple days. We went to see them at the Valley Forge Music Fair in Pennsylvania. We went to see them at a college in Pennsylvania. I remember the last time that I saw them together, and our older sister Peggy Ann was there, and some of the younger boys, and my sister Ann. And we went to the Wildwood Convention Hall down in Wildwood, New Jersey.
Right.
And they were there with Cheech Chong.
No.
And yeah, so that was big. And there we did knock on the back, you know, door, and they let us in, and we visited in the dressing room first, and then we went out and sat there. And I was pregnant at the time, and I remember what I thought was one baby was, you know, kicking me from inside like a. Like percussion,
right.
you know, along to the beat of their
future
music.
Drummer.
And yeah, but we found out, you know, after I delivered that one, that there were actually two babies kicking.
Oh,
so
wow.
That's
holy
why
smokes.
It felt like I had a band within me.
Exactly. Stop the presses, a bass player too.
Yeah. So it was in the blood, you know? So anyway, we watched the show, and that was really enjoyable. And then we saw Maury in September, just days before the plane crash.
Wow.
And so we have that sweet memory of being with him on a Sunday, and then he left on a Tuesday and died Thursday.
And was that your last that was your last time seeing him? Did you speak with him any time after that last moment?
No. From the time that we said goodbye after we had a picnic on a Sunday, that was the last time I spoke to him.
Wow.
Because once they, you know, they went on the road, you know, you're taking your stuff in and out of cars and airplanes and stuff. And my mom may have spoken to him, you know, on Monday or something, but I don't think so.
Right.
It was an exciting time, and we knew that he was busy. But he called home all the time, so he may have called home and talked to Mom in those couple days before.
Right, and it's such a, I mean, words cannot express what kind of the loss that your family suffered from that. As a family, how did you carry on, I mean, knowing, you know, discovering this, that your brother had passed away in this plane crash. How did you guys really cope with that moving forward?
Well, I think it was tragic for each of us, you know, in our own way. And, you know, I'm definitely very vocal about, you know, Maury and how I feel. And I would stop people in, you know, grocery stores if I heard it on the,
wow,
the sound system and say, "That's my brother." And they'd say, "Really? I love that song. Your brother was Jim Croce?" And I'd say, "No, that guitar music, that's my brother."
Wow.
You know, so, and anywhere I was, I didn't care. I tell everybody. But, you know, and I'm sure my siblings do something similar, you know, when they're moved by hearing the music and they're with somebody. But we all, you know, we all missed him so much that sometimes it was hard to even talk about him.
Right.
Do you know what I mean?
It must have been hard to hear those songs at that time, but now what you have is you're instantly back with him.
Instantly.
When you hear those songs, he's the house painter on those. Like, Jim's the house and he painted that house. And how I'm relating to this is one of the beautiful things that you have shared with us is that Maury's story is one where he shared his art with his loved ones. And professionally, when a lot of people get to leave the house and start a career in rock and roll or whatever, your Metallicas and so on, they can't wait to get out of the house. Maury went on the road. As soon as he came back into town, he's like, "Come on over, all 10 of you, all 12 of you, or whatever.
Yeah.
Come to the hotel room." Like, Cheech and Chong are opening for Jim Croce. He's like, "Come on over, Cheech and Chong are here."
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then ultimately, like, he shares that with his loved ones, you know, his favorite sister, and you wind up sharing that with everyone else. And do so honor them and his memory. It's a wonderful story.
Yeah, his legacy, you know, does survive, you know, with us being able to tell people about him. And we're all proud. And I guess one of the things that it came down to for me was that very shortly after Maury and Jim died, Cashman and West, whose love for Maury and their admiration for him was obvious to me, as a 23-year-old young woman, I noticed that they wrote a song on an album that they put out in 1974, and they called it Maury, and it's absolutely beautiful, and it's on my website about Maury. And in it they said, you know, how sad it was that Maury died, and that the world would never know him.
Right.
You know, because I guess, you know, everybody thought at that time, nobody really knew him. It was Jim's name that was going to be big. And I always thought to myself, well, why won't the world know Maury? You know, I'm going to tell everybody. And I did for years and years. And then all of a sudden, I heard about something called the Internet.
Right.
WWW. I was like, what is that? And I thought, wow, this is my chance. I'm going to make sure that the world does know him.
You know, talking about the website, which everybody who's listening can check out, which is MauryMuehleisen.com. The website, you've got the original Gingerbreadd album reissued, and it looks gorgeous. The layout and the booklet is fantastic. But I also, we played a couple tracks from it this morning. The other album is an album, a collection of Maury's, I guess, private demos, recordings that he did. And why I really appreciate this is because it's a great comparison between, say, the finished product and, of course, the original thoughts that of Maury's that he just put down on record for his own, you know, demoing sake. Can you tell us a little bit about that record, the Before the Ever Since album, and how that came about?
I had tried a few times to try to get Maury's Capitol Records album reissued somehow. I didn't know how, but I wrote to Capitol Records, and I may not have stated what I wanted completely, but there were relatives and friends who said, how can we hear Maury's album? I lost my album. Mm. You know, nobody plays it on radio anymore. And so I tried and tried with no success. And so I went to Tommy West and I said, do you think you could help me put together, I said, I have Maury's recordings of those same songs and other songs that he wrote, and but could you help me put together those 11 songs and maybe two other songs that Jim Croce fans would be familiar with, Salon and Saloon, which is on Jim's third album, because
right.
Jim didn't have enough songs to fill the third album, and I Remember Mary, which they would be familiar with from an anthology called The Faces I've Been that Cashman and West put out about a year after Jim and Maury died. So I said, people would know those songs, and maybe they'd like to hear Maury's renditions of them. So Tommy helped me, and I got connected through him with a mastering lab and had them, you know, with the sound quality levels all put together and the spacing of time between the songs.
Right.
And so I had a finished CD and designed the actual CD with an old reel-to-reel of Maury's music. And then and I had them put together in the order that they were in Maury's album.
Right.
And I said to Tommy, you know, we'll write liner notes and I'll have this all ready, but let me just try one more time. So I tried one more time at Capitol Records and got a young lawyer, a female, who was very interested in the story of me wanting to get Maury's music out. And she talked to her boss, who was a vice president, and he said, oh, go ahead, do whatever, you know,
wow.
Make it happen. And so I was like, oh, my God, this is going to happen. And so I decided to put them both out, because when I listened to the songs on Before the Ever Since, which are the early demos and home recordings, I feel like I'm home with Maury, and
right.
I hear him. I hear him in his bedroom. I feel the walls around us, and I can hear him breathing. I could hear that this morning, even when you played it on your show.
Wow.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, when you record live like that and on tape, you're going to hear the room. So you're actually listening to your brother's bedroom.
Yeah.
It's funny. I was listening on the headphones, and there's a moment. I don't know if you heard it or you're familiar with it.
Oh, I know what you're going to say.
But there's a moment where you can just hear him kind of move, adjust himself in the chair.
And there's like a little floorboard.
Yeah.
That kind of creaks.
The reason why is because he wanted to get the sound of a recording studio, and he wanted a fade out.
Mm.
So his room was big enough for a single bed, a bureau, and a desk.
Well, she's giving us
and
good stuff.
It was a very small room. He had the middle room on the second floor. And what he would do is he would tape the song at his desk, and then he pushed back from the chair as quietly as he could, but obviously not completely quiet.
Right.
And he would back up across the floor all the way into his bedroom closet.
Is that right?
How about
which
it,
which was about the size of, it's like 2 feet wide.
Right.
That was the reverb chamber.
Right.
Yeah, so that was the sound that you were actually hearing, and I appreciate that you took the time to notice that.
Oh, yeah. From when I put that album on for the very first time,
we did not discuss this. We were both thinking about the same thing, but that's the beauty of these recordings and the gift that you gave everybody.
Right.
Is they're so personal. It's like a fingerprint or something.
And it's a great companion to the full album.
Mm-hmm.
It's such a beautiful collection of songs. I was going to ask the you know, with this resurgence of vinyl, but you know, a lot of records are coming out. A lot of people, I've heard United Pressing Plant in Nashville, the biggest pressing plant of vinyl records in North America, is now opening up a second location for them to produce more vinyl records. Is there any thought or hope to get Gingerbreadd back on vinyl?
You know, Of course.
No pressure, by the way.
Yeah, yeah. I'll buy one.
I would love to. But, you know, Capitol, by the time that I did reach out and get a response from Capitol, they already were another record company.
Right.
They were EMI.
Okay.
And now they're Universal Music. And so my first contract with them, my license to be able to put this out in CD form, and I did that all myself. I paid for... I studied and put together all my liner notes and typed up all the words to Maury's songs and went to disc makers in South Jersey
right.
and put that whole package together myself. Capitol or EMI wasn't, you know, on board for doing anything other than I report to them twice a year and pay them a royalty on each one that I sell. So, you know, and I appreciate everything that they've done. I mean, I'm so grateful that they let me put it out. They own the master recordings to those Gingerbreadd songs. So
wow.
That's why they have the right to do that. But I, what was I going to tell you?
Trying to put this out on vinyl, maybe.
Oh, so, and so I, you know, I had a contract with them for 7 years, and I was able to renew for another three.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm hoping that they'll still be interested in even letting me, you know, continue doing this with the CD sales. I'm only allowed to sell them through my website.
Right.
I could definitely approach them. I would love to. I had heard about the fact that vinyl is coming back into vogue, and, you know, that would be nice, because one of the things Maury and I really loved, as nice and clean as the sound is on CDs,
yeah,
you know, one of our big memories is sitting and listening to those, the clicks and pops,
oh,
and
right.
watching the needle go up and down on a vinyl record.
I live for it. That's
yeah.
I mean, and also not to mention, I mean, that original album recorded intended to be played on vinyl.
Yep.
It would be such a full circle kind of experience to get it back on there, to see the artwork all blown up and big, and
yeah.
and to be able to read the lyrics. I was gonna ask you. You know, you've mentioned possibly, I guess, online about potentially putting together a book about Maury's life. Is that in the works, or is that something you're still toying around with?
Well, I'm not toying around with it, but, you know, I've never written a book before, and I had always wanted to write down, talk about vinyl. I'm using a real old phone, and... and that just fell on the floor.
We've got a anyway. Party line here.
So, a landline. So, I wanted to always write down the fun little stories that we told at the dining room table. Maury and I, you know, would tell about the day the bat got in the house and flew all around. And we had the younger kids, you know, laughing. And we had tons of stories that, you know, and they'd say, oh, tell us that again, you know. So I wanted to save those stories and on paper somehow.
Right.
And, you know, I always was a typist. I'm a medical secretary by college degree, but so I could type. But, you know, if you put a piece of paper in a typewriter, it's not the same thing. And then when I found out about computers, I thought, yeah, this is good. I can add and delete and all that kind of stuff.
Right.
So I started putting those stories down. And... for the family, and then found out that there were a lot of fans and people out there who would love to know more about Maury. And the more I got into the internet, the more I learned from the outside world, and I already had a lot that I had saved. And my parents were both still alive when I started the book, and I typed the whole thing up, and they read it, and they loved every bit of it.
Wow.
You know, so they said, you know, don't give up. Make sure you definitely get this out there. We want everybody to know about Maury. And so I'm editing and, you know, adding and tweaking. And I'm going to cross my fingers and say, you know, I hope maybe before the end of this year.
But
it isn't the only thing I do in life, so.
Of course.
And I've never done it before. So, you know, there's some anticipation and... You know, but I want everybody to know more about Maury. I do have the website and got stories from each of my siblings and from Kenny Loggins and the record producers. The record producers, by the way, you know, a lot of people buy both of the CDs, the Before the Ever Since and the Gingerbreadd.
Right.
It's all you can get. Sure.
It's so amazing. You know, I didn't know if people would like one or the other better. But people are buying both of them, even though they're mostly the same songs. Mm. And it's just fascinating to know that people are interested in hearing both sounds, because we were just always blown away and amazed by what the record producers did.
Right.
To these quiet little mm-hmm. songs from home. Cashman and West, you know, just did a fantastic job.
You know, you mentioned on the website, there's a lot of comments from other musicians who Maury touched their lives. Kenny Loggins being one of them. There's the story, Kenny Loggins was working with Loggins and Messina. Jim and Maury opened up for them. And I guess there's a great story about Kenny Loggins and Maury mm-hmm. writing a track. Do you remember the story behind that song?
Yes, Maury and Jim opened two times. I think they were on the road with Loggins and Messina, each for maybe a week to 10 days. And Maury and Kenny Loggins did the laundry. You know,
right.
Here's four guys on the road going to Holiday Inn after Holiday Inn. And, you know, Maury would say to Jim, give me your underwear and your shirts and socks and stuff.
Aye, aye, aye.
And Kenny would do the same with Jim Messina. And so they would gather the four guys' laundry, and they would go down to wherever the laundry room and the Holiday Inns were all across the country. And they'd put a load of wash in. And Kenny said, you know, I had a dream about this, the apocalypse. And the four horsemen and... you know, raining and stuff like that. And he tried to describe this dream to Maury. And he started to write down some words, you know, to a song. And Maury said, oh, that sounds neat. How about this? Just the same way he would do with Jim.
Right.
And so they'd be back in the room for that. And then they'd walk down and take the clothes out of the washing machine and put it in the dryer. And go back to the room, and next thing you know, there'd be a little bit more sound and a little bit more words. And this song grew. Now, they actually called it, Kenny called it Kenny's Dream at the time. And then Maury died. That was in August of 73. And Maury died in September, only about a month later.
Wow.
And so Loggins and Messina put together their own version of that. A couple words may have been changed from what I heard Maury play, because Maury sang that and for us and said, I wrote, you know, wrote this song with Kenny Loggins.
Right.
And so Loggins and Messina put an album out called Motherload, and one of the songs was called Fever Dream, and indeed it was this song that had earlier been titled Kenny's Dream.
Right. And it's amazing, again, another... A connection to Maury is, I mean, obviously Kenny Loggins became a household name in the 70s and 80s and had a huge career. And there was your brother, you know, affecting his life. And and it's just amazing how far his talent went and touched so many people. And the last thing I wanted to mention is the last song Jim Croce ever recorded was one of Maury's songs, The Salon and Saloon. Mm-hmm. And it's one of those songs, I believe Tommy West calls it a piece of art. Just one of the most beautiful, not a pop song, but just a piece of just gorgeous melody and lyric, and mm-hmm. and the fact that it was Jim's last recorded song is such a statement, I guess. Does that song for you have any kind of special meaning, I guess, with those circumstances?
Yes, it does. I mean, I think there's a great irony in it, because the song is about saying, meeting a friend at a train, you know, saying goodbye to a friend and meeting a friend, and life is all about people who come and go through our lives.
Right.
So I think that's kind of ironic. It's also kind of ironic that you played Maury's version that I put on the Before the Ever Since CD.
Right.
And that is Maury at home on his guitar, and it has its own little sound, and of course that is the way I remember it mostly. But then when you hear it on Jim's album, the ironic thing is that Jim and Tommy saved this for last, and Maury has no part on that song on Jim's album, other than that he wrote the words and the music.
Right.
But Tommy West plays the piano, and it's just a very quiet, heartfelt song that Maury wrote when he ran into a friend from high school when he was seeing off someone he had only just met that weekend. And this Mary Mitchell was seeing off her friend, and they were at the Trenton train station where Maury and Jim frequently took the train to New York.
Mm-hmm.
And they turned and saw each other, and it was like, wow, you know, I haven't seen you since high school. And they spent the day talking together. And so I think it's almost a metaphor for all the times that people go in and out of our lives.
Right.
And wish you had more time to spend with them, you know, and I'm glad they took that afternoon, because Maury created this beautiful, beautiful piece of music from it that he sings beautifully, that Jim sings beautifully, Tommy West plays the piano. It touches my heart every time, and I am in touch with Mary, because of course I knew her. I was only a year behind Maury and Mary in high school, so I knew a lot of his friends. And so when you know who the people are that the songs were written about, and you remember, you know, walks home from high school with your brother, and, you know, it's just, you know, shoes soaked all the way through to your socks.
Right.
On rainy days.
Man.
And just all the memories that you have come rushing back when you hear all these songs. And I'm so grateful to everybody for wanting to hear his music, and for you, both of you.
Well,
Eddie, you'll have to play Eddie.
You know what? I've got it queued up, by the way.
Okay.
I thought it was a sign when I heard Eddie for the first time. I was like, this might be one of my new favorite tracks.
You're giving us diamonds, Mary. This needs no polish.
Exactly.
Well, I'm so happy to have been able to spend, I mean, I don't even want to say goodbye, but I know our time is short, but I've loved spending this time with both of you, and I'm sorry he didn't do a song about Jeremy. But Eddie is a sweet little song, and if you're going to play that next, I'll just tell you that when he was at Glassboro, he did actually see a little man on a park bench just off the edge of the campus, you know, drinking from a paper bag covered bottle.
Sure.
When you listen to Maury's songs, just like with Jim's, you can close your eyes and see everything that they're saying.
Mm-hmm.
You
right.
know? They were real.
I almost felt like it was about me.
Oh, really?
not to get into that. We'll get into that's a whole other show. But
call me later and tell me.
Exactly. But Mary, I gotta say, I want to thank you so much for spending this time with us and talking about Maury and sharing these incredible stories and giving us such an incredible insight into, you know, his life and his legacy. And I want to let everybody know that both of his records are available on MauryMuehleisen.com, and there's a great amount of information and stories from his friends and family. And if you have the book when it comes out, mm-hmm. please let us know. We'd love to have you back on the program.
Oh,
thank
yeah.
you. And thank you for widening the circle.
Thank you for warming up the booth. It's freezing cold out here in San Francisco. We can see our own breath in front of us. You have shown a beam of love into our miserly studio. So thank you, Mary.
Yeah, and we really do appreciate it, and we'll stay in touch, and of course we'll play some more tracks as we pay homage to Maury Muehleisen. Thank you so much, Mary.
Thank you so much.
You got
take
it.
Take care.
And have a great morning. Bye bye.
You too. Bye bye.
There it is.
What a wonderful guest, Miss Mary Muehleisen. Jeremy, I got to be honest. What a sensational morning.